Yes. For those of you who don't know me, I'm the son of Pastor Albert, and he's not here today, so we can talk about him as much as we want. I won't tell. So he decided to send his only begotten son to deliver the word this morning. And I'm going to talk to you about the fourth commandment. How many of you here keep a regular Sunday routine? Same thing every Sunday for the past how many years? You've been doing the exact same thing. Now, for me and my family, it's been a little different the past couple of years because I got married and my dad became a pastor. So it's been a little different. But prior to that, we had the same routine for many, many years. We'd attend the 9:30 service at St. Francis Square. Anyone here who used to attend that same service, 9:30, St. Francis Square, we'd attend that. Then we'd have lunch at the same restaurant every Sunday. Then we'd all go home and take naps, everyone, on Sunday. And at night, we'd, the six of us, my parents, myself, and my three sisters, we'd have dinner, just the six of us, every Sunday. The only thing that would change once in a while is if we'd go see a movie or not, if there was anything good. But the funniest part of that Sunday was waking up. Because, you know, it's a weekend and you want to sleep in and we're all night people, except for my dad. So we want to wake up. For 9:30 a.m. service, we had to leave the house at 9:10. So we had to be ready by about 9. So that meant I wanted to wake up as late as I possibly could so I could get in as much sleep as possible because I only need about 15 minutes to get ready. But my dad would wake us up, Pastor Albert, he'd wake up the earliest of all of us. He's a morning person. So he'd, 7:30 a.m. 7:30, that's too early for a Sunday. He'd open the doors and go, it's really irritating. Okay. But he'd wake us up, and he'd wake up my sisters. But no one would wake up, except Nika, the sister next to me, because she's a morning person as well. But the rest of us would not wake up. And like clockwork again, after he takes his shower, at 8:45, he would wake us up again. And you had better be getting ready at 8:45 or else. Okay, so at 8:44, I'd set my alarm. And by the time he'd open my room to check if I was up, I'd be in the bathroom. He didn't know I was just there for 10 seconds. Okay. Now, my sisters, this was, I didn't ask you guys if I could share this, but I'm going to share it anyway. When you go in their room, you can't see the bed right away. You see the hallway, the short hallway, and then the beds are somewhere here. So at 8:45, my dad would open the door. Are you guys ready? I wish I had a stopwatch from transition from REM deep sleep into standing up. It's like 1.32 seconds. It's amazing. Two of my sisters, it's like deep sleep and then standing up, you know, almost blacking out because they stood up too fast. But they were so talented at it. This happened every Sunday. That was our routine. I wish I had a video of that, but they wouldn't let me show it. It's hilarious. So that was our typical Sunday, and today we'll be talking about something along those lines as we continue the book, our series in the book of Exodus. And today we'll be discussing, or we'll be talking about the fourth commandment. And when I was informed that I would be speaking on the fourth commandment, I was a little nervous because the fourth commandment is a little different than all the other commandments. It's a little bit more complicated. If you know, there's a lot of opinion, even within the church, on how believers ought to keep the fourth commandment. There are denominations that exist because of differing views of the fourth commandment. So I really had to study hard and make sure I'm preaching the right thing according to the Word of God. So we'll be doing a little bit of a Bible study this morning just so we understand how we ought to relate to the fourth commandment, and then we'll be going into some practical applications later on. So this is the fourth commandment. Could we turn this on? Okay, could you read this with me, please? Remember the Sabbath and by keeping it holy. To the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son or daughter, male or female servant, For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them. But therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, would you help us understand how to relate to the Sabbath this morning? I pray, Lord God, that you would teach us all you want us to learn. Would you fill me with your Spirit as I deliver your word? May it be your words coming out of my mouth. And I pray, Lord God, that you would just prepare every heart here to receive it. In Jesus' name we pray. Okay, first question, what is the Sabbath? What is the Sabbath? In Hebrew, it's pronounced as Shabbat. Say that, Shabbat. Shabbat sounds better than Sabbath, Shabbat. It means to stop or to cease. And the commandment was to cease from work. Now, nowadays, we have sort of a different definition of what work is, because we equate work to what we do for a living. So if you're a businessman, stopping from work means not conducting any business. If you're a policeman, then not doing your work, not doing police work. Or whatever you do, it's to stop what you're doing and to not do it. But it meant something sort of different to the Jews. The word for work here is melaka. And melaka generally refers to the kind of work that is creative or that exercises control over your environment. Just like the work God did when he created the universe. That's a typical example of melaka. God ceased from working on the seventh day. However, down the road, the Jews took this definition a little further, because the word melaka was also used when referring to the work done in the sanctuary, done for the tabernacle. Therefore, they concluded, the spiritual leaders of the day concluded, that any work related to the building of the sanctuary would be prohibited on Shabbat, on the Sabbath. Therefore, they came up with 39 forbidden tasks, 39 things that you could not do on the Sabbath. Again, this is how people interpreted it, not necessarily what God meant when he gave the command. So this is a sort of infographic on what you cannot do on the Sabbath. Extinguishing or kindling a fire cannot be done on the Sabbath. In modern times, you can't even switch on a light. You can't turn on a flashlight. You can't press anything electronic. Why? Because it lights a small fire. It lights a spark. Electricity. So in modern times, on the Sabbath, your lights better be on or you can't turn them on at all during the Sabbath. Another one is, there is no tearing that can happen on a Sabbath. Whether intentionally or accidentally, you cannot tear anything. When you use the bathroom, you have to use the whole roll of toilet paper. It cannot be torn, even the cardboard. You cannot tear it. I'm serious. No hitting with a hammer, and so many other restrictions. In fact, there are some inventions that were made so the Jews would not violate the Sabbath. If you took the Holy Land tour, I'm sure you saw the Sabbath elevator, where every button was on the Sabbath, so you didn't have to press anything. You can't ride a car on the Sabbath, because every time you step on the accelerator, it burns something. So they had to come up with inventions. This one is for the refrigerator light bulb, so that when you open it, it stays off. Yeah. So the Sabbath became sort of something different. And the typical Sabbath today, people start getting ready on Friday afternoon. They get off early at work to prepare for the Sabbath, turn on what they need to turn on, cook what they need to cook, because there are some restrictions around preparing food on the Sabbath. They set timers. And then when the Sabbath starts Friday evening, Sabbath is on a Saturday, and the Sabbath is a time of prayer, a time of fellowship. They attend service. So that's the Sabbath. And that's the Sabbath today. Next question. Why is the Sabbath important? I'll go through this quickly for two reasons. Number one, it honors God as creator. In Genesis 2, 1 to 3, it says, "Thus the heavens and the earth were completed in all their vast array, By the seventh day, God had finished the work he had been doing. So on the seventh day, he rested from all his work. Then God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because on it he rested from all the work of creating that he had done. This is the first time in the Bible the word holy is used, and it referred to the seventh day. The word holy, as many of us have heard before, means to separate. It's a day that's different from the other days. It's separate from the other days. And it's holy for three reasons. Those three reasons are three verbs highlighted in blue. Number one, completed. The work of creation was completed on how many days? In how many days? 6 days. Six 24-hour days, God created the universe. And on the seventh day, he rested because it was completed. The work of creation was complete. Second, he rested. He rested. Creation being complete, God rested. Did he get tired? Does God get tired? No, the Bible says God does not grow weary. God does not sleep. He rested in the sense that he stopped working, but it was a rest of satisfaction. Well, how did God describe his creation? He said it was very good. And he rested. He was satisfied in his creation. It was a rest of satisfaction. And the third verb is blessed. He blessed the seventh day and assigned it as a special day for his creation in its original perfection. And calendars all over the world are in units of seven. It's because on the seventh day, every seventh day is a reminder that God is creator. It's a reminder of the magnificence of God in creation. And every Saturday, for many of us, is the day we actually get to enjoy creation. For those of us who don't have work on Saturday, it's a day typically for us to enjoy creation, for us to engage in recreation. So the first reason the Sabbath is important is because it honors God as creator. Number two, it honors God as lawgiver. As lawgiver. Exodus chapter 31, starting with verse 12. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Say to the Israelites, you must observe my Sabbaths. This will be a sign." Remember that. "This will be a sign between me and you for the generations to come, so that you may know that I am the Lord, who makes you holy. Observe the Sabbath, because it is holy to you. Anyone who desecrates it is to be put to death." God was serious about his people observing the Sabbath. "Those who do any work on that day must be cut off from their people. For 6 days work is to be done, but the seventh day is a day of Sabbath rest. Holy to the Lord, whoever does any work on the Sabbath day is to be put to death." He was really serious. Mentioned it twice. The Israelites are to observe the Sabbath, celebrating it for the generations to come as a lasting covenant, a sign, a covenant. "It will be a sign," verse 17, "between me and the Israelites forever, for in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day he rested." It's a sign between who? Me and the Israelites. That's important, and we'll get into that later. So in verse 12 and in verse 17, it says, the Sabbath is a sign. It's a symbol. When I got married, there was a symbol to our marriage, which was the wedding ring. In the Noahic covenant, in the covenant God made with Noah, which is, "I will never destroy the earth by flood again," what was the sign? Rainbow. Abrahamic covenant, "I will bless those who bless you," God told Abraham. "I will curse those who will curse you. I will make you a father of many nations." What was the sign? What was the symbol? Circumcision. And for this covenant, what was the sign of this covenant? This is the Mosaic covenant, the covenant God made with Moses, which is, "If you obey me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all nations you will be my treasured possession. Although the whole earth is mine," verse 6, "you will be for me a kingdom of priests," meaning a representative of me to the nations. and the holy nation. These are the words you are to speak to the Israelites. This is the covenant God made with Israel. What's the sign here? The Sabbath. It is a sign of the Mosaic covenant. And I believe God chose the Sabbath as the sign because taking the day would allow Israel to reflect on God as lawgiver. It allowed Israel to reflect on the covenant that God made with them, that if you obey me, I will bless you. So the Sabbath was important because it honored God as creator and honored God as lawgiver. This is a critical question. Are Christians required to observe the Sabbath? Tell your neighbor, what do you think? So this is where we really need to get into the Word to make sure we're preaching the right thing. Now, if you look at the New Testament, you will not find the commandment of the Sabbath repeated. There is mention of the Sabbath, but you will not find observe the Sabbath repeated in the New Testament. And if you ask me, is that important? Well, I'd say yes, because all the other 9 commandments are repeated multiple times in the New Testament. Remember, Jesus came to establish a new covenant. What's the new covenant? That salvation is by grace through faith. That Jesus died for our sins, and believing that we will have eternal life and we will be saved from eternal separation from God. The new covenant says that we are sinners, but God made a way for us to approach God, to come before God. God made a way for our sins to be forgiven. That's the new covenant. That salvation is through Jesus Christ. Let's read this verse, Hebrews 8:13. By calling this covenant new, he has made the first one obsolete. And what is obsolete and outdated will soon disappear. We see that all the moral laws were repeated in the New Testament. Moral laws, law on murder, obeying your parents, the laws on idolatry, all of these were repeated in the New Testament. And in fact, Jesus was stricter about moral laws. He said, being angry at someone is similar to murder. He said, looking at a woman lustfully is just as if you committed adultery. He was even stricter with moral laws. However, the commands to practice ceremonial laws, such as dietary restrictions, such as circumcision, sacrifice at the temple, observing special days, observing the Sabbath, were no longer mentioned nor required in the New Testament. The book of Galatians was written to Christians who received preaching from the Judaizers. Who attended Galatians class here? Some of you attended Galatians class. They were preaching to Judaizers who were saying Christians need to receive Jesus and to continue the dietary restrictions, practicing circumcision, and all these other Jewish traditions to be saved. Paul said in Galatians 4:9 to 10, it's on the screen, but now that you know God, or rather are known by God, how is it that you are turning back to these weak and miserable forces? Do you wish to be enslaved by them all over again? You are observing special days and months and seasons and years. I fear for you that somehow I have wasted my efforts on you. Paul is saying, guys, pinag-usapan natin to. Remember, we spoke about this. Why are you going back to thinking that you need to do these things to save you? We are no longer required to practice the special Jewish days, months, and years. They were for the Jews. In Colossians 2:16, the last verse on the screen, therefore do not let anyone judge you by what you eat or drink, or with regard to a religious festival, a new moon celebration, or a Sabbath day. The verse is saying, do not let anyone hold you to a certain diet, observe Jewish festivals, or practice the Sabbath. Nobody should judge you nor keep or force you to observe the Sabbath, because the Sabbath is gone. It's not part of the new covenant. So what are we doing here today? What is the purpose then of the fourth commandment? Is there no longer a special day to honor God? Should we go home? We'll talk about the answers to these questions as we proceed. There are two important principles that we can learn from the Sabbath. Two important principles. Though we are not required to obey the law, we can pick up some principles from the Sabbath. The first one is the principle of rest. The principle of rest. Anyone here in the corporate world, quite a bit of you here working a, it's supposed to be a 40-hour a week job. Can you honestly tell me that it's 40 hours? No, I worked in the corporate world for a decade. It's not a 40-hour week. You know, it's a lot of work, and I think a lot of people nowadays are tired. And they say technology was supposed to make our lives easier, but technology is making our lives harder. Because now, guess who's the slow one in the whole work process? It's people. Before, you couldn't do certain work because you're waiting for something to arrive in the mail. Now, everything is instantaneous. So we're the bottleneck. And that's why I think one of the reasons why people are so tired. Now, before we go into see what the Bible says about rest, we need to put this into perspective by seeing what the Word of God says about work. Here's some verses on work. Could you read this with me? Proverbs 24, 33 to 34. A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest, and poverty will come on you like a thief and scarcity like an armed man. When I was feeling lazy and my mom would see me feeling lazy, she used to dictate this verse to me. A little sleep, a little slumber, you're going to go broke. Colossians 3:23, whatever you do, do work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for human masters. How then are we supposed to work? If you had the perspective that you were serving the Lord, would you not work diligently? Give it all that you've got? Be excellent at your work? 2 Thessalonians 3:10, for even when we were with you, we gave you this rule, the one who is unwilling to work shall not eat. The Bible is full of verses about diligence, verses against laziness, verses about excellence and working hard. So how do we marry this concept with rest? Do they contradict? You know, God modeled the right balance for us, and He modeled it in the creation account, as we read earlier. Exodus 31, for 6 days, work is to be done, but the seventh day is a day of Sabbath rest. On those days, we work hard. We give it all we've got. We do what is expected of us as unto the Lord. But on the seventh day, God said, you must rest. It's a day of Sabbath rest, holy to the Lord. Whoever does any work on the Sabbath day is to be put to death. The Israelites are to observe the Sabbath, celebrating it for the generations to come as a lasting covenant. God did work. He did the work He was set out to do within 6 days, and He rested on the seventh day, even if He didn't need to work. Even if He didn't need to rest, 6 days of diligent work in creating the universe, and He rested. And He rested for it to be a model to us. He was very serious about telling His people to rest. However, we learned that, as we read earlier, that the Jews took the Sabbath a little bit too far. And when Jesus came into the earth, many times the Pharisees and the religious leaders of the day would rebuke Jesus of what He was doing on the Sabbath. Let's read what He said in Mark 2:23-27. Read this with me, please. One Sabbath, Jesus was going through the grain fields, and as His disciples walked along, they began to pick some heads of grain. The Pharisees said to Him, look, why are you doing what is unlawful on the Sabbath? Remember, who invented the Sabbath? God invented the Sabbath. Jesus is God. So it's funny that they were saying that. 25, Jesus answered, have you never read what David did when he and his companions were hungry and in need? In the days of Abiathar the high priest, he entered the house of God and ate the consecrated bread. This was something that was forbidden on the Sabbath. but which David did, which is unlawful only for priests to eat, and he also gave some to his companions. Then he said to them, and this is something that shocked the Pharisees, verse 27, then he said to them, the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. The Pharisees were teaching Jesus, the inventor of the Sabbath, how to observe the Sabbath. It's like teaching an inventor how to use his creation. But Jesus gave us a great truth, and as opposed to the heavy burden and all the restriction of the Sabbath, he said the Sabbath was for our benefit. It was for the benefit of the Jews. He said, he said even something more shocking when he said, I am the Lord of the Sabbath. I can do whatever I want with the Sabbath. The Sabbath was made for man. It was for your benefit. It's a gift. The Jews made the Sabbath restrictive and burdensome, but Jesus reminded them that the Sabbath was made for them, for their benefit. It was intended to be a day of rest, to reflect on God as creator and as lawgiver. But then it became a day of drudgery, day of working harder not to break any of the commandments, or the forbidden tasks. Instead of a day of that the Jews would look forward to, it became a day that was a burden. And that was not the intention of our Lord, not to be a day of fear and constraint, but a day of blessing and of rest. God wants us to rest. He modeled it for us. My question to you is, do we set aside a day to rest? Do you set aside a day to rest? To let go of work, focus on God, focus on family. God modeled it for us. Some of us are worried about leaving our calendars blank on a certain day, thinking I'm unproductive, something's going to go wrong. But if God modeled rest for you, will He not fill in the gaps for you? Will He not make things work out? Because He knows you need to rest. He created us. And rest was so important to God that He modeled it. We need to rest. There's an example in Exodus 16 where the Israelites were in the desert, and then they had to collect manna. But they were only allowed to collect an omer, which is about less than a gallon. And anything that they would collect above that would rot, because God was teaching them faith. He's teaching them faith. I will give you your daily bread. But on the sixth day, which was what day of the week? Friday, they were allowed to collect double. Why? So that they wouldn't have to do it on the Sabbath, so they could rest on the Sabbath. And it says in Exodus 16:27, nevertheless, some of the people went out on the seventh day to gather it, but they found none. Then the Lord said to Moses, how long will you refuse to keep my commands and my instructions? Bear in mind that the Lord has given you the Sabbath. That is why on the sixth day He gives you bread for 2 days. Everyone is to stay where they are on the seventh day. No one is to go out. You guys need to rest. In verse 30, so the people rested on the seventh day. Don't feel guilty about resting. God made sure the Israelites rested. Some of you refuse to rest. Some of us refuse to rest. We need to schedule a day where we do nothing but rest. That goes for our church workers as well. Obviously, Sunday is not their day of rest. Everyone's working here on Sunday, everyone working for CCF. But they have other days of rest. And would you help them honor those days for rest and set them aside for rest? Even Pastor Albert, we can talk about him, as I mentioned. He works hard. He really does. And I need to tell him to practice this. And he has been. But you know, sometimes there are concerns that need to be handled. We need to be disciplined in saying, not today, if it is your day of rest. Work as hard as you want on the days that you have to work. But we need to rest, to have a day of rest. And I learned this the hard way. In January, no, today's the 14th, so it's been a month since I left my high-stress corporate job. I'm no longer connected to my previous company. And I was working there for 9 years. And in January, I was transferred to this new role, super high stress. Lot of work that needed to be done, lot of things that were not done because of the transition of people and stuff. So I had a lot on my plate. And the start of the year was super busy because a lot of things happening, lots of events. And I had to work really, really hard. And I did not rest. I worked really hard. I was stressed out. I got little sleep. And I failed to trust God to fill in the gaps for me. So I did not rest. I thought, if I don't work on this, things are going to fall apart. And maybe some of you feel that way. But I felt that way then. If I don't work on this, things are going to fall apart. Who's going to do it if I don't do it? It's a lack of trust in God. And I learned the hard way because sometime late February, after a week of hard work, we were at a convention. Then after the convention, went out in the sun, then back into this hotel because I had meetings and stuff. The evening, as I step out in the hotel, this was late February. I'm 30, in my early 30s, and I like to keep fit. Especially that time, I was exercising a lot. I was watching my diet. When I stepped out, I felt a numbness in my mouth, and I felt a disorientation. I walked back inside the hotel, and I tried to speak to the guard beside me to try to tell him that something's wrong, and I couldn't say the words I wanted to say. Turns out, I was suffering from a transient ischemic attack, which is also a mild stroke. This is 4 months ago. I learned the hard way, and this is probably why God is teaching me to, or allowed me to give this message, because He's teaching me and reminding me of the need to rest. And because I did not rest, you know, I stayed at the hotel that night, and my wife went to rescue me in a cape. No, she came to rescue me. And then I went to the hospital the next day, and God made sure that I rested in the hospital. And I pray that none of us would be forced to rest in the hospital. We need to rest. God made our bodies. He knows how our bodies work. You need to take a day of rest each week. If you're an employer, you need to make your employees work rest one day each week. Work one day each week. I'll work for you. Rest one day each week. We need to refresh our bodies, refresh our spirits, recharge. That's how what God modeled for us. So I want you to ask yourself, are you following God's example of rest? Are you getting enough rest? The first principle of the Sabbath is rest. The second principle is the principle of keeping a holy day. The principle of keeping a holy day. Now, this is very, very interesting. And when I was studying the Word of God, what the Word of God said about keeping a holy day, now in this New Testament age, I was blown away. And I'll share that with you. The Bible tells us that though the Sabbath is gone, the principle of keeping a holy day set aside for the Lord is still a principle to be followed. What day was the Sabbath to the Jews? What day? Saturday? Yeah, it was Saturday. You ever wonder why we come to church on Sunday? Well, if the Sabbath of the Jews was Saturday, why are we here on Sunday? And how come in anywhere in the world, every country, every continent, what day are the people of God, what day are Christians gathering? Sunday. What day did your parents go to church? How about their parents? Sunday. How about their parents? Sunday. Up to the time of the church, everyone was meeting on Sunday. Why is that? Is it an accident? Could it be arbitrary? Could it as well have been Thursday or Tuesday? Why Sunday? Remember earlier I spoke about the Sabbath and how it honored God as Creator and honored God as lawgiver. Well, in this New Testament, in the church age, we observe a new day which honors God as Savior, which honors God as Redeemer. And let's look at how it all started. Matthew 28, After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary, Mary the mother of James, went to look at the tomb. What day was it? After the Sabbath. If the Sabbath is Saturday, what day was this? Sunday. It was Sunday morning. Verse 2, there was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, he has risen. Just as he said, come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly." And we'll find out later why he said, the angel said, "Go quickly. And tell his disciples he has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you." So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell the disciples. Suddenly, Jesus met them. "Greetings," he said, and they came to him, clasped his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." This is Resurrection Day. Prior to this day, Sunday had no meaning. It was just like Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. This is Resurrection Day. In verse 7, Jesus says, "Go quickly," because it's going to be a very eventful day. So the women called on the other disciples. Peter checked out the tomb. He found it empty and rejoiced. This was the morning of Sunday. And in verse 9, they came to him, clasp his feet, and worship him. And verse 9, here we find the first ever Sunday worship service. It was a small service, but it was a service of worship. And you'll see in the next few verses that the ladies called the others. So that all happened in the morning. In the afternoon, there was a different scene. Two of Jesus' disciples were walking on the road to Emmaus, and suddenly a man comes to them and says, "What's going on? What are you guys talking about?" And they go on to tell him about what happened that morning. They tell him about the resurrection. Luke 24, 25 to 27. By the way, they had not yet recognized Jesus. They didn't know it was Jesus. Luke 24, verse 25. He said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things, then enter his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in the scripture concerning himself. And in verse 27, we see the first Sunday sermon given by Jesus. He spoke about what the prophets, what the Old Testament said about this day, about resurrection, about the resurrection. So after this, the two disciples on the road to Emmaus invited Jesus, or this stranger, to them, to spend the evening with them, to have a meal with them. And then in the midst of the meal, God opened their eyes. They realized who was with them this whole time. And then Jesus disappeared before their sight. That was just the afternoon. Eventful day so far, but it's not over. Let's see what happened in John 20, 19 to 21. On the evening of the first day of the week, so it was still Sunday, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And he said that because they were scared. After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And let's continue the account of Matthew. In verse 16, but the 11 disciples proceeded to Galilee, to the mountain which Jesus had designated. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some were doubtful. And Jesus came up and spoke to them, saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. And then he says those words written up there, go therefore. It's not there anymore. Sayang yung drama. It used to be there. Verse 19 and 20, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. The Great Commission was given on this Sunday. The first worship service, the first Sunday sermon, the Great Commission. It's a day that the Old Testament was fulfilled. It's the day that the law, the prophets, and the psalmists have been talking about. It has come. It's a day that sin and death were finally conquered. It's a day of resurrection. What day was it? Sunday. And Sunday would never be the same again. Trivia. What day was the church born? What event? It's in Acts chapter 2. It was a day of Pentecost. It's a day of Pentecost. When the Holy Spirit came as promised by Jesus, and he indwelt the apostles, and they were able to preach with power, and people with different tongues could understand them. And from then on, the Holy Spirit would indwell all those who believe that Jesus is the Savior and Lord of their life. On this day, Peter is preaching about the resurrection. In Acts 2:38, it says, Peter replied, repent and be baptized. Baptism, which is the symbol of the new covenant. Baptism. Every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off. For all whom the Lord our God will call. Salvation is for everyone. With many other words, he warned them and he pleaded with them, save yourself from this corrupt generation. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to that number that day, about three times as many people that go here on Sunday, on the day of Pentecost. Another marvelous day, the birth of the church, the coming of the Holy Spirit. You know what day of the week it was? Pentecost happens to fall on a Sunday. Is there any New Testament commands that we are supposed to celebrate Sunday and gather together on a Sunday? There are none. But we have the very obvious fact that God allowed the most special days of our faith to happen on a Sunday. Resurrection, the birth of the church, Pentecost, all happened on Sunday. We've left the Sabbath behind and we now have a new day. And in those days, in the early days of the church, they would meet every day. But after some time, they settled on a specific day. In Acts 20, sorry, I forgot to flash this. Acts 20, on the first day of the week, we came together to break bread. Paul spoke to the people, and because he intended to leave the next day, he kept on talking until midnight. And some of you will find that I'm talking too long. Paul spoke until midnight. So we're also going to follow his example. No. There were many lamps, verse 8, there were many lamps in the upstairs room where they were meeting. Seated in a window was a young man named Eutychus. I don't know why he was sitting on a window. Who was sinking into a deep sleep as Paul talked on and on, which shows that even the greatest of preachers can put people to sleep. So if anyone's sleeping here, you are excused. When he was sound asleep, he fell to the ground from the third story and was picked up dead. In verse 10, Paul went and threw himself on the young man and put his arms around him. Don't be alarmed, he said. He's alive. Paul said, I'm not done teaching. So he brought him back to life, and you're not done listening. Then he went upstairs and broke bread and ate after talking until daylight. He spoke until daylight. The man must have said, you should have just left me dead. What day did this happen? After many years after the Pentecost. Look at verse 7. What day were they meeting? On the first day of the week. What day is that? It's a Sunday. Sunday. In Revelation, we find John gives this first day a name. Revelations 1, 9 to 10, I, John, your brother and companion in the suffering and kingdom and patient endurance that are ours in Jesus, was on the island of Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. Verse 10, could you all read verse 10 with me? On the Lord's day. Then we, I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet. What day was it? It was Sunday, and Paul and John called it the Lord's Day. You know, when we refer to Sunday as the Sabbath, we all know what we mean. Right? We call Sunday the Sabbath. We know what we mean. But to be biblically accurate, what we celebrate on Sunday is not the Sabbath. We celebrate what? The Lord's Day. That's why the message today is to keep the Lord's Day holy. On the Lord's Day, we had our first worship service. We had the first Sunday sermon. The Holy Spirit came. Jesus gave the Great Commission. The church was born. The law and the prophet were, law and the prophets were fulfilled. Sin and death was conquered, were conquered. It's all happened on the Sunday. And today, 2,000 years later, we continue this tradition of the church to meet on Sunday, to celebrate our redemption, to rejoice that Jesus is risen. That's why we're here on Sunday. We're here to celebrate the day that Jesus overcame sin and death. Do we worship only on Sunday? No, we worship every day of our lives. But Sunday is special. Sunday is holy. And holy is not just, holy means to separate, but transferred to a vertical concept, it means to elevate, meaning it's a day that's above all days. It's a day that we celebrate God as our Savior. It's a special day. And today we meet. Today we meet to read the Word, to listen to the Word of God, to worship, to fellowship, just like they did in the early church. Because of Jesus, Sundays are never the same again. Praise be to God. I want to show you this video to help us appreciate what Sunday means to us. Maybe after learning what the Bible says about Sunday, I'm sure some of you have seen this video, but may it have more special meaning to you now.
It's Friday. Jesus is praying. Peter's asleep. Judas is betraying. But Sunday's coming. It's Friday. Pilate's struggling. The council is conspiring. The crowd is vilifying. They don't even know that Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The disciples are running like sheep without a shepherd. Mary's crying. Peter is denying, but they don't know that Sundays are coming. It's Friday. The Romans beat my Jesus. They robe him in scarlet. They crown him with thorns. But they don't know that Sundays come. It's Friday. See Jesus walking to Calvary. His blood dripping, his body stumbling, and his spirit's burdened. But you see, it's only Friday. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The world's winning. People are sinning, and evil's grinning. It's Friday. The soldiers nailed my Savior's hands to the cross. They nailed my Savior's feet to the cross. And then they raised him up next to criminals. It's Friday. But let me tell you something. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The disciples are questioning what has happened to their king. And the Pharisees are celebrating that their scheming has been achieved. But they don't know It's only Friday. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. He's hanging on the cross, feeling forsaken by his Father, left alone and dying. Can nobody save him? Oh, it's Friday, but Sunday's coming. It's Friday, the earth trembles, the sky grows dark, my King yields his spirit. It's Friday, hope is lost, death has won, sin has conquered, and Satan's just a laugh. It's Friday. Jesus is buried. A soldier stands guard, and a rock is rolled into place. But it's Friday. It is only Friday. Sunday is a coming.
Praise God that Sunday has come. And because of Jesus, Sundays will never be the same again. Question to you is, to all of us, is Sunday really the Lord's day to you? Search our hearts, Lord God. Reveal to us if Sunday really is the Lord's day to us. Help us set aside the things of the world and set our hearts only on things above this day, especially on this day, as we honor you as Savior. Lord, would you teach us to rest as you have modeled for us? Would you teach us to honor you on this special day, that this day would be not about the things we're going to do after church, not about the other stuff we plan to do later, but about this time where we honor you as our Savior. Help us keep this day above all other days, as it is the Lord's day. In Jesus' name we pray.